Hello, hello guys. Welcome back to another SciCraft server tour. And yeah, we got a pretty large crowd today. And that is because we have a lot of new members all over here. Let me go through them, because it's been really long since the last tour. And well, so here we have Rechen Machine, Smokey, Robotic, Alon,
hello.
And Tab, who joined us over time. Yeah, welcome to all of you guys. And, well, then we have two guests for today's tour. So that is Cryo. He's usually live streaming on 240p. And we also got Adam. He's a map maker, and that some folks here met at Minecon. And yeah, he's one of the authors of Diversity 3, for example. So yeah, glad to have you guys here. Hope you will enjoy the tour.
Thanks.
Glad to be here.
All right, and yeah, today we got two main stations that we're gonna visit. So one is a new furnace array, because the old ones just were too slow. And we got another quarry, so that's definitely exciting to see. And I suggest we head right off. Woo! Oh yeah.
Very angry.
Everyone taking a photo at the same time.
All right, and
Nether portals are still laggy. Wait, I'm still not there, Rego.
You're still not? Oh gosh.
No.
Okay, yeah, we're just gonna wait here. I mean, what else do you do at a subway station than waiting for a subway to arrive? Or in this case, in order to get people out of the subway. Yeah, well, could take a while. Oh, Mango also made it. So, yeah, we just arrived. Basically via subway, which is kind of fitting since we came from the Nether. Okay, so all sorts of things.
Classic.
Yeah, some people got a bit too much into map art.
Yeah.
But let's take a look at the whole building, which is a pretty massive thing. Let me just fly up a bit.
Maybe Mango can explain the machinery first.
I would say we actually enjoy the building first. I mean, it was Manny's part, and then you get go over to Redstone.
Okay. So then this is obviously a factory building. This is around the furnace array. First, Mango built the furnace array, then I made the building around it. And my job on this server has become pretty much annoying the other members when it comes to building things in survival. So as you've seen, I've made a few cars, and I wanted to make some Easter eggs in my build. So what I did is, if you go to the other side, there's a door which you can go through, and it's a warehouse inside, and there are many Easter eggs inside that you can look for. So there are 48 boxes, I mean 48 slots, whatever you call them, and each of them has a different thing inside. So for example, I could take slot 2A2, so second row on top. It's lumber stock, so wooden logs attached with rails. And underneath is future lumber stocks, so basically just saplings. And it's 48 different things like this. Yeah, right next is a SpongeBob statue here, for example. I had fun making this. And yeah, you can go through and visit it, go around and see funny things here and there. There's also a car in one of the slots.
Yeah, so not all of these make super much sense. But yeah, there's definitely some fun things.
So here at the end of the warehouse, there's the storage that Mango made.
Oh yeah, so we run the furnace array on coal, just stored in shulker boxes that we have here in those chests. At the moment, got about 5 double chests worth of charcoal left. So there's about 500,000. Still smelt 4 million items with it. So there's not much to explain about the storage. this just delivered to the furnaces. We can maybe take a look at that later. And empty boxes go in here.
Okay.
Right.
So
did we actually prepare something to smelt so we can run the furnace array?
Oh.
Probably not. Maybe we should make a little cut and get something like
boxes. We are quickly gonna grab something here.
Meanwhile, I can explain the other side quickly. Basically, the other side of the
way to the end of the road, there's our flower farm forest. So it's kind of included now.
Should we just go upstairs to the control room?
Yeah, sure.
They go in here.
Okay.
I have 24 boxes in the second chest.
Already saw it.
So here we are in the main control room of the furnace. Let's just put it into the input box, I would say. Yep. Furnace array works best if you have multiples of 24 Schalke boxes. It's just going to put 24 in there. Nobody?
Should I? Oh, let me take care of that. Got them. So they're all taken out rather quickly. And yeah, we use the Schalke boxes directly to spread it over multiple subarrays. So you can see here the 12 lamps indicating which of those is running. Mm-hmm. And you can also see the frames are dropping now a bit, just because there's so much going on.
Oh yeah.
And I guess the server... Oh, now the server is actually doing fine. Okay.
Server should be fine, but your frames might go down.
Yeah.
Okay, now we got the 12 lamps on, indicate that 12 of the modules are running. There's also another lamp blinking that wants you to not leave the area while it's running. We can take a look at the redstone. If you go to the top level of the furnace array, and you get a bit of an overview of the whole thing. So it's really massive. In total, we got 1,728 furnaces here. And you can also go to in spectator mode if you're just getting around to seeing stuff. So we've got 1,728 furnaces here that are fueled by charcoal, and the items are delivered to the furnaces for the minecarts. So there's first system at the top that distributes the Schalke boxes to each module individually, so all of the 12 of them. That's equally split up, and then just distribute the items to the furnaces. Everything is at the bottom, then also put into Schalke boxes again. There's a lot of redstone going on. I'm not sure to how much detail we should go. I explained most of it in my SciCraft episodes already, so I'm not sure, Rego.
No, I don't think.
Yeah.
Go through every little detail.
Yeah. So, yeah, everything is put into Schalke boxes at the bottom, then via dropper elevator is brought right back to the input.
Yeah, now also the lag has ceased a bit.
Yep.
Oh well, the client-side lag. Still pretty bad. Okay, yeah, this is really massive and it's really packed with a lot of heavy components. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's definitely a really cool thing.
It's also possible to go to the actual furnaces. There's an entrance at the back. So in case something goes wrong, we have the possibility to take out items out of the furnaces, which was important, to be able to reach them. So this would be a problem if somebody puts in items that can't be smelted by accident. There's no way to filter those out. Then I hope this never happens. But if it happens, we can also take out items out of the furnaces. What's also noteworthy is that the furnaces are perfectly timed. It takes 200 ticks exactly to smelt an item, and an item is delivered exactly every 200 ticks. And this way, if you put in 24 Schalke boxes of items to be smelted, you don't also waste a single piece of coal. Yeah, One of the features it also has is it would work with mixed items in case somebody accidentally puts different items in there. Wouldn't break the furnace array, but definitely works better with a single item type.
Yeah, and I mean, that's the bulk use that we have for it, that we really smelt a lot of things, like 24 shulker boxes of sand to get a lot of glass for a build. And usually 24 is not enough, so yeah, the sort of the ideal thing to have a multiple of 24 is a very simple requirement for us. Because, well, yeah, everything else doesn't make a lot of sense.
How much time does it take to do like 24 shulkers?
It takes a bit longer to start and stop the furnace array. It's like a couple extra minutes. But it can do, if it's running over an hour, so it can do 600,000 items per hour. So it takes about 10 minutes now for the 24 Schalke boxes.
Yeah, unfortunately it's still choppy.
It'll take a while until the first batch arrives.
Yeah, I mean, here we have some additional indicators.
Actually good. You can make even a larger furnace array than this one here, but I think we're fine with that amount. We already used it to smelt, I think it was 2 million terracotta into glazed terracotta. It was one of the larger operations yet. Of course, we also smelted all the logs in order to get the coal for it. Yeah. Just massive. I guess we just have to wait until items arrive.
Yeah. So I guess we'll wait
what
a couple minutes.
On the right, do in the control room, right at the end. What does that?
Oh, that's some technicality. We could the charcoal refills itself. The first array refills itself with charcoal. And there's an extra mode if you want to refill a bit more, so it stops when all the furnaces have a stack of charcoal, and there's hoppers in the back, they could also be filled up. So if you want to just keep refilling over the normal threshold, then we can activate that there.
Okay.
There's also indicator lamps that if you run out of charcoal, tells you that. Also stops the furnace array automatically. So we tried it to make safe as possible. In case something goes wrong, it stops the furnace array as well. And yep. Also requires some empty Schalke boxes sometimes, because the items have to be filled into those. So there's also a little storage for empty boxes. But yeah, normally takes the boxes directly to put into the furnace array and puts the items back in there. Oh yeah, the first batch of glass is it's finished. Yeah, there's 24
nice.
Boxes of white glass in the bottom right chest. It's done.
There's more to come, I think.
Oh, we put in 24.
Yep.
I put in the rest.
Oh. Well, then it's still going to be busy for a while. And I guess we'll be back. All right, so we made it over to the next station. The large wall here is actually part of a different project and different perimeter that we'll show you soon. But yeah, you see a nice large hole here. And well, it's actually not completely down to bedrock, which also means there was not a World Eater running here. But instead, we built another quarry. And yeah, this is mainly to nose design. Where are you?
Here?
Ah, just below. Yeah, so shall we just take a flight to the place where quarry is currently located? Because this thing has been running for like 2 weeks now. Well, technically like 3 days effectively, but spread out over 2 weeks. And
yeah, it crashed several times and we didn't have it running all the time because it was lagging for some.
Yeah, so still it's pretty impressive size of a hole that it made already. And of course, since it's a quarry, that means we're actually collecting the items and not just blowing things up.
If you fly close to the floor, you can see lots of diamonds everywhere.
Yeah, so how far down does it actually reach?
At mines, to Y7, so the bedrock layers are not mined, and the two layers above that are only mined every sixth block.
Okay.
So under the flat floor, there are those lines you could sometimes see when there was a cave.
Okay, and...
rendering in is incredible.
Oh, yeah.
So you can see we almost reached the ocean. And then it will stop in the ocean eventually.
Yeah, the plan is, I think, to go about 500 blocks further out. There's actually on the other side an ocean monument, which we also want to mine. So we will also get some sponges from this quarry.
Actually, that's on the neighboring trench.
Yeah. Yeah, it's part of the second quarry, so this quarry is a bit laggier than the one we built before, since it grabs so much more terrain at once that we can't make it like 700 wide like the last one anymore, so this is only 288 blocks wide, but overall it's faster. But,
yeah, currently when you stand next to the quarry, you can really nicely see the wall that it can grab upwards.
Yeah.
So there's every second block is a sticky piston, and between the sticky pistons are slime blocks, and the whole terrain attaches to those slime blocks, and then it moves up a whole slice of the world at once.
Okay. Should we do a demonstration of that? At the moment, the quarry is parked at a lower position, so there's basically one huge flying machine. The next thing that will happen is it pushes the flying machines one block forward, and then all the slime will attach to the terrain, and then it flies back up and brings it up. Okay. Somebody can probably can maybe start it?
Yeah, I will do it.
Okay. So now we're starting it. It's going to be super laggy. I think we're just going to run it for one slice and then try to explain the rest of it. Unfortunately, the quarry is really laggy. We did not expect it to be this laggy from tests before. We assumed it would maybe run at 60-70 MSPT, but it's way laggier, despite only being like 20% larger than a quarry that ran at 50 MSPT.
So I'm going to start it and run it upwards, and it's not going to go back down again now.
Yeah, so it only brings the blocks up, blows it up, and then it stops again. Okay, there we go. Now it pulls everything up.
And make sure to not fly into the TNT. Otherwise, it should be safe to fly anywhere.
Yeah, it's pretty laggy.
Yeah, the TNT is...
It's probably best to go in spectator mode if you can't fly. It's also better for the server. So, do you want to explain how we get the items?
Yeah, so the blocks are moving up with the flying machines and then unloaded into the blast chamber. And the TNT explodes in a precise timing, so the TNT explodes while the blocks are moving, and that's why they have a 100% drop chance. And then the water stream is just low enough so the items don't explode and are out of the range of the TNT. And the items are going all the way to the side into the water stream that we built along the quarry. And if you follow them, you come to the storage room over here, where we first filter out the cobblestone. That's 70 double speed cobblestone sorters. And we almost need all of them.
I think I've seen it. Was for the first storage, it's actually already the second storage we built. Up to 60 were used, so we actually need that.
Yeah, I think 63 or something were used. Mm. Of course, not always, but that was the maximum.
Yeah, really insane amount of items coming in. It's about 400,000 items per hour. So we sort out about 260,000 of that as cobble and just destroy it, and yeah. getting dispensed into lava, and then the rest is put into like previous quarry into just shulker boxes. We don't do any sorting. We just fill up the shulker boxes with the items and do the sorting afterwards. Probably going to use the same system we used for the old quarry.
So the advantage of sorting it later on is that we don't miss out on any items, and we really just remove the cobblestone because it's worthless. And yeah, otherwise, if we would forget a filter or some filter is a bit overflowing, things might not be picked up, and yeah, that way we really can pick up anything that comes along.
Right now, there's a good moment to look at the block shield of the quarry. If you come to the side of it, you can see the pistons at the very bottom of the grabbers push forward a shield of block. And that is for removing liquids like lava and water that are in the way. Because if they flow in and activate some observers, the quarry might break. But that prevents most of the water and lava flow.
What does the top layer do with the white concrete?
The roof, you mean that?
Yeah.
Yeah, the roof is just copied from a Comet's or Mango's quarry. It's a three-layer roof, and you need that, so even when the roof is moving forward, it blocks all light, so no light can get through.
Okay.
So only one layer moves at a time.
Yeah. We actually tried to run in such a quarry once without a roof, and the light updates completely killed it. I mean, that's already laggy, but without a roof, it's pointless. So it's really required to have the roof on top.
Yeah, so that way we ensure that it's always dark, which would work with a double layer roof already, but of course, since the roof has to move as well, well, you need the third layer.
Yeah, blocks that are getting pushed are also transparent. So if you push to, like, the second layer of blocks, then it's the light updates. We need three layers for that. Okay, now the quarry has parked, right?
Yeah, it parked in the top position now, and we could send it down. Actually, I would like to do another cycle so I can show the bottom station in action.
Yeah, let's do that.
So I will start the quarry again so it can go downwards.
Heck. Holy heck. It's actually difficult to move around, even in spectator.
So you might have noticed already that the quarry doesn't have trenches on the side like quarries normally have. And that is due to this layout where the blocks are grabbed with a sticky piston in the that's going upwards, and the bottom station also doesn't have any slime blocks on the side. So that's the only reason you can actually make a quarry without a trench on the side.
Yeah, that's actually much more difficult than it sounds. Because these restrictions really can bite you.
Yeah, I put a lot of effort in actually not needing a side trench. And that's why the bottom station actually became so huge. If you look at it, the most complex part of the quarry is the bottom station.
Yeah, it even has some parts that are seemingly underground.
Yeah, there's the blue terracotta at the very bottom, which is pushed by some pistons which are buried by some blocks. And the terracotta is necessary so the slime blocks of the grabbers don't stick to the terrain below. And if they stick to the terrain below, you couldn't push them forward anymore. That's why the terrain below has to go, and we need terracotta there.
Okay, I guess we have to send it up now, right?
I think I enabled it going up already.
Okay.
It just waits for the failsafe. It checks if all grabbers went down correctly, and then it starts. Here we go.
Oh yeah. Yeah, the system is insane.
And you already saw the terracotta moved forward by one block. That is for in case there is a gravel that's pulled up, it has to be crushed immediately. Otherwise, you can't get rid of the gravel anymore.
So is it timed in a way that the gravel would basically end up in the block and then pop out?
Yeah, the gravel starts falling and then the terracotta is pushed in before the gravel lands.
Okay, and then it can't land, so neither on top nor inside the terracotta.
Yeah, exactly. And then the bottom station for some time does nothing. Gresham, do you have some sand or gravel?
I could go to the storage quickly if you want.
No, don't.
What?
Don't need...
No, I mean the Crowy storage, not the main storage.
Better not.
I have some to know.
Yeah, can you place some on the bottom station so we can show the crushing?
I guess replacing the stone, right?
Yeah, just replace some stone here.
What do the armor stands with the boots do up near the water?
Are they freeze?
Those are Frostwalker armor stands because we have to move the water forward. And as you might know, you can't move water. What you can do is move frosted ice. So we freeze the water, move the frosted ice forward, and melt it again this way.
Ah.
We move the water.
That's clever.
That is super clever.
Yeah, it's become quite a standard trick in these kind of builds by now. Okay, so I guess we'll have to run it.
Why did you guys originally decide to build one of these instead of like a normal world eater or something? Like, why did you guys decide to design something that just kept all the blocks?
It's built in a mesa biome. The terracotta there in 1.12 is not renewable. So the only way to get it is either build a quarry like that one here or mine it yourself. And yeah, it's actually not really worth it to run a quarry like that one through normal terrain, since mostly you get stone and yeah, uninteresting stuff, but mostly for the terracotta.
We should go to the bottom station now because stuff is about to
happen. Yeah.
So when the grabbers went completely up, the problem is that we have to get some blocks out of the wall because the grabbers have at the very bottom, they have normal pistons, and those have to be pushed forward as well. But we need, of course, a gap in the terrain to push forward the normal pistons. And this is why we have to pull back the three blocks at the very bottom. And currently, it's spamming them back and forth. So if there's any sand on top of them, it's all also getting crushed. Which also just happened. Now the interesting part is it pulls back all the blocks.
It goes up and over.
Yeah, and that makes it so complex, so big bottom station. It also has to be liquid proof and stuff.
Okay, so just to explain again what happened. So it basically pulled back one row of blocks and just stored them here sort of in between itself, like in a slice that's completely reserved for these blocks. And, well, then basically just jumped over them with the small grabber part here in order to bring them back into place for the next slice.
Yeah, and the good part about it is that these blocks just stay behind and make a flat perimeter floor. So XCOM is saying we have to talk about the speed of the quarry.
Yep.
It's actually quite fast compared to Mango's quarry, for example. It's 2 minutes and 40 seconds per slice. That's about, I think, 5 or 10 times faster.
5.
Yeah, but of course, we can't make it as wide as Mango's quarry because it also lags a lot more.
Kind of limited by lag, but it's also... If you break it down, a bit more lag efficient still. And in terms of items power, it's probably like twice as fast then, if you take that into consideration.
On the same CPU, of course.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
How much terracotta do you guys think you're going to get out of, like, just this one quarry going through a mesa?
Several million of each color. It's probably around, I think, about 2 million normal terracotta, so the brown stuff. And then of the, yeah, depending on the colors, a bit less of orange, yellow, red, gray, so on. Also, what's nice is dirt. 112 is not renewable. We had issues before getting enough dirt on the server. The quarry is no longer an issue. It's nice.
I suggest we wrap it up here. And yeah, thanks everyone for joining. Thanks to our guests. So Cryo and Adam.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you.
Hope you enjoyed the tour. And yeah, we'll see you guys next time with another tour. Hopefully not in a year, but a bit shorter. So yeah, till then, take care and see you next time. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye.